My name is David Best, and I'm a student at Woodland Hills High School. I know that the Tuskegee Airmen were an African-American group that fought during World War II, and my grandfather happens to be one of them.
My name is William Hicks. I am a Tuskegee Airman. I was a non-commissioned officer with the Tuskegee Airmen group, and my duties were that of an aircraft electrical specialist. The Tuskegee Airmen was a group of young black men, and we wanted to serve our country. We had planned to join the regular Air Force, but because of segregation policies, we were not wanted. The word segregate itself means to separate, to isolate, and to set apart. That's all I allowed it to mean to me. I didn't, because if you become involved with that, it can defeat your purpose. Okay.
Well, I know that they were a group of African Americans that sort of had to prove themselves that they could be able to fight.
Once I think about it, it's amazing to see, you know, how much he changed history, like him and his group.
We could not afford to fail. Failure would have been a tremendous setback for black aviation. There were, however, a lot of people who were hoping that we would fail. If we had failed, then they would be able to say, well, I told you that they could not fly airplanes. I told you that they didn't have the ability to do technical jobs. And a lot of them were in high government places. But they wanted us to fail. But on the other hand, there were so many, many more who were hoping and praying that we would be successful. And of course, we were successful. The results speak for themselves.
I am Sharon Hicks Ward, owner of the Calypso Caribbean Grill. Well, it was actually something that my husband and I had talked about doing for a long time. So when we had an opportunity we found a location and a number of things kind of fell into place. So when we had the opportunity, we said, you know, we're just going to go for it. And we liked entertaining, we liked to cook, we liked people. And I had a chance to leave the job that I was in. I was in a corporate job. And I had a chance to leave there, and we decided this was the time. So we went ahead and went for it, and here we are. One of the people who's the greatest influence for me is my father. When we were growing up, he always had his own business. So we grew up with that sense of being, entrepreneurial. Even when he worked another job, he always had his own business on the side. So we always grew up with that sense of having your own business, running your own, you know, just sort of being in charge of your own fate.
At one time, I operated a radio and television store in Chicago, and I think that might be why my children have that. And my wife was also into the clothing business. I think that's how Lynn got into it and Sharon got into it.
One of the things that was most amazing for me is that my dad, who is now 89, but at the time that he did this, he had retired and had been retired for, maybe 15 years, that he started a landscaping business. And that to me was just amazing that at his age, it didn't occur to him as a time to stop or a time to slow down, but it was something that he wanted to do, and so he just started a landscaping business and went out, secured customers, grew the business over time, and up until last summer was still working it. So that's one of the most amazing stories to me. And it's actually encouraging because, you know, if I can keep going like that when I'm his age, I'll feel real good about it.
I remember one time, as an aircraft electrical specialist, I was called on to repair a motor. The crew chief is the man who was in charge of the airplane. He called me, he says, "Hicks, my plane is overheating. What can I do about it?" I said, "Well, let me take a look at the motor. I'll see if we can find out what's wrong with it." Up underneath the airplane, we were using P-51 Mustang. We need to leave that on. Underneath here was a little shutter. When the shutter was open, the motor would run cool. When the shutter was closed, the motor would overheat. And if it would overheat, the plane eventually would go down. So I went to the warehouse. I said, "I need a motor for this plane." So he went back and looked. And he came back. He said, "No, we don't have this motor." I said, "Well, when can you get one for me?" He said, "We can't get it." He said, "The plant back in the United States is on strike, and we can't get it." I said, "Well, that seems quite odd here. This is wartime, and the plant is on strike." So I made a couple of trips up there trying to get it, and he still didn't have it. So I said, "Well, the only thing I can do is to repair it." I went into my tent. We didn't have anything. We didn't have machinery and equipment, things like that out there. The only thing we had was a tent, and I think I had a trunk about 3 feet long. So I went to the airplane. I said, "Well," I said, "I'll have to pull it out." I took that motor out, and I took it into my tent. And I completely disassembled it, took it apart, piece by piece, laid it down. And I found out what was wrong with it. It seemed like there was oil coming out of the engine, and the oil was getting onto the commutator, and the commutator was hot enough to cause the oil to bake on there. So I cleaned it out good with crocus cloth. It didn't use sandpaper. And I got it cleaned up very good, put it back together. I said, "Now, what I need to do, I'm going to try it out a few times, see how it worked." I tried it out about 2 or 3 times, and it worked perfectly. I said, "Okay then, since it's working good here, now let's take it out to the plane and put it back in there." I took it out to the plane, put it back together. We ran it up and down a few times. It worked perfectly. I said, "Okay, the next thing we have to do now is to try it in actual flight. Let's put it in the flight and see what happened." So we took it up. The pilot took it up, brought it back down. I said, "Well, how did it work?" He said, "Fine, no problem." Okay. Now that we see how it's working, I have to make a decision. I said, "Well, let's put it in combat." Next time the group went on a mission, we went with them. And of course now, when the plane returned, there's only one plane I'm looking for. That's the one that I worked on. So he came back, the pilot jumped out. I said, "Well, how did it go?" He said, "Fine, no problem." Now, not only did we have that particular plane out, but there were 7 of them out. We only had 28 planes in that particular squadron. So that was 1/4 of our group. I was able to get most of those planes back in service. And I tell you, that was a feeling. The fact that I knew my job, really paid off that time.
It means a lot to me to have a father who is a Tuskegee Airman. And it's interesting that growing up, he didn't talk a lot about it, but then after we were grown, he began to talk more about it. He began to tell stories about it. He began to talk about the lessons that he had learned, life lessons that he had learned as a result of being a Tuskegee Airman. And I think the things that they went through at the time, and he often spoke of it as they fought a battle on two fronts. They fought the battle against the enemy, and he was in the European theater in Italy. But then they were also fighting a battle back home against racism. And so when you look at the fact that despite all of that, they were still able to stay focused, they were still able to do outstanding things. And I mean, these were young men in their early 20s, late teens. It's encouraging to me when I think of what they were able to accomplish against just incredible odds and to still achieve just outstanding things and still keep a sense of excellence. And you know, when any time you try to do something, there's always a lot of factors that are working against you, and they're I mean, that's just the way it is. And I guess it just gives me a lot of encouragement, because I figure if they could do something of that magnitude, then whatever it is that I'm dealing with, I'm sure I can handle. So that gives me a lot of encouragement.
Well, my answer would be this. I love America. America is my home. America did not mistreat us. Some of her people did that. I think of America as a land of the free and a home of the brave. A place where you can be whatever your abilities allow you to become. If we had allowed those injustices to dwell with us, we would never have been able to do the job. We didn't come to get even. We came to defend our country. We came to prove that Black Americans can and will serve their country equally as well as any other American. That is what we did, and that is why we came.
He just inspired me to just keep going on, keep trying. You can do it. You can beat the odds. You can just be whatever you want to be.
Brother, help me please.